tanks?
Tanks!
You're welcome.
But what is our tanks? Is this a tank? Are these tanks? How come it's called World of Tanks when everything takes place in a field? And if you're supposed to keep fish in tanks, then why does the water keep getting out? And why won't they let me take this one home? And why are the cops after me now? You never take me alive! All this and more on this unashamed parody of In the Field.
I was going to call it In the Battlefield. We already did that joke, didn't he?
Of course you did. I guess I'll just do my own thing.
And do we want me to say it?
I don't know. what are we supposed to do here?
I don't know.
I've never done this before. You tell me.
All right, well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I am the host of this show, and I'm here joined with Blazer Pig.
You're not the host. Who made you the host? When did you become the fucking host of this bullshit?
I don't know. I'm just, you know.
Okay.
I'm just vibing, man. This is a great show. You know, we're going to do some great art. It's going to be like Bob Ross crossed with a little corruption and a little schizophrenia. So,
Okay, let's get this Let's get this shit show on the road. What'd you say?
Yeah, I'm down. Yeah, throw it at me.
Okay. So here's the scenario. You fucking basement tier YouTuber. Okay, here we go. Right. So
thanks.
I'm joking. I love you. You know this.
I know.
Yeah.
So, it's okay. It's tough.
Here's the scenario. Okay. The two of us have magically been transported into another dimension where Mike Sparks is the president. And Pierre Spray has won. And, like, Pierre Spray's in charge of the Pentagon. The reformers won. Mike Sparks is the president. And we have been commissioned, because we are obviously the smartest people in the land. It's like, what's that terrible film that everyone's seen and keeps referring to? Idiocracy. You ever seen Idiocracy?
I have not.
Okay. Well, it's like that film Idiocracy that you've never seen. So basically, we are the smartest people on the planet. And we have been called in to President Mike Sparks' office, and we have to design the new infantry fighting vehicle. We have to design the Mike Sparks.
All right. Well, first of all, it is an honor to meet the president, of course.
Of course, yes. Have you ever met Mike Sparks?
Never before, actually.
I have the unfortunate problem of I have actually met Mike Sparks.
Are you serious?
Yes. I've spoke to him over a Skype call.
He's got a thug, you know, odd job, who's got a hat that he can throw and use as a weapon. Again, how do you weaponize a hat? I think what Ian Fleming is doing in his mind's eye, saying, okay, I can't talk about UFOs. What looks like a UFO?
And what I'll say is that there are actually two Mike Sparks. So if he's the president and we're meeting him, what he'll do is he'll sit there and he will call us a Zionist. And
okay.
A dirty Jew and various other things for about half an hour, and then once he's done, he will kind of relax a bit and he'll actually sit and talk to us, and he'll talk to us about all his military strategy and everything. So when I met him, he had this absolutely brilliant idea, and his idea was like, here's the scenario, okay? You have a bunch of armored vehicles, a convoy of armored vehicles moving through enemy territory. They're on a deep strike mission. This mission is going to take about 2 or 3 days for this column of armored vehicles to complete. You know, they're going for the capital. They're trudging through a jungle and swamp or open desert or whatever. Anyway, they're going to take a long time for them to do this. You understand? Militaries do this all the time. They send armored vehicles out on several days worth of long expeditions for no apparent reason.
Yes, of course, and they always have the proper amount of fuel and everything
for such
a long trek.
Yes, so we've got the armored vehicles, and we've got the large supply convoy of trucks following them around with all the fuel that they're going to need. So, Mike Sparks has this wonderful idea of what is the best thing to equip these units with. Let's say APCs, okay? So
okay.
A whole column of APCs with troops in the back and all their equipment. On these deep strike missions, this idea that he comes up with in order to make their lives a lot more comfortable and a lot happier. I'll give you one hint, and that hint is that this vehicle that he has created has two driver seats.
Okay.
It has two driver seats for a reason. I want you to tell me why. What is the defining feature of this vehicle that he has created?
This is a tough one, actually, because you know, it's hard to get into the mind space of you know, the great Mike Sparks, but
granted.
In case one becomes incapacitated, the other one could take over?
I mean, you're close, but no cigar. I'll say one of them becomes willingly incapacitated.
What the fuck? Okay. is one of them the pilot of the detachable wings that flies off?
Oh, now that would be a good idea. But no.
All right, well, clearly I just got in here because of, you know, I was lucky and there were not many other resumes that were thrown in. So enlighten me, please.
Okay. So you are on this long expedition. It's going to take several days. You're in this small, clamped armor vehicle. You're driving along. Your relief driver comes in, and he says hello to you. He sits in the opposite driver's seat. And what do you do? Well, obviously, you can take your hands off the wheel, but you can't go into the back because there's nothing there, because that's where all the other troops are. So instead, you fold up the driver column, so there's no steering in front of you anymore. You then pull over you this plastic bag, which zips up. Okay? You following me so far? Are you following me so far?
Yes, I see where you're going.
You're now in this big plastic bag, which completely folds over you. And above you is a shower faucet. And you get naked, and you have a shower.
Okay, so I'm taking a camping shower inside of an armored vehicle right now.
A camping shower inside of an armored vehicle, presumably with this gigantic water tank on the top of it, which is supplying the shower with water.
Well, yeah, it's also the drinking water, too. It's a two-way system.
Oh, hell yeah. And presumably everyone else in the back, all the other troops, also have the system where at any point they can just decide to just zip themselves up into a bag, get naked, and have a shower.
So first off, this vehicle is going to be big.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so we're not talking like... What's the width of the current Gavin in service?
I have no idea.
Let me look at... Well, we have Google, so...
Tell us, oh Google!
All right, M113 dimensions.
I think you'll find it's called the Gavin.
Yeah, my mistake, sorry. Okay, combatreform.org, there we go.
There we go.
That's okay, he's the president, not a graphic designer. Alright, so we're looking at 190... What fucking unit of measurement is this?
I'm looking
at a diagram of the...
It's the unique Mike Sparks unit of measurement.
Okay, fair enough. M113 length. M113 Gavin length.
Just look at fucking Wikipedia. It's going to save us a lot of time here.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay, 15 feet long... and the width is 8 feet. So we're looking at 4.8 meters long and 2.68 meters wide. So we need to pretty much double that.
Yes. Have you ever seen those tanks that drive around? They're like stretch limos, and there's always a bunch of like blonde bimbos on a hen night in the back.
Yes.
Yes. Basically,
I know exactly what you're talking about. Yes. We can't let it get too tall because, you know, it won't work as a scout, like, you know, in Pentagon Wars.
Yes.
So the height is going to remain the same. It's going to just be a stretch Gavin. And,
we're
going to make it a little wider, too.
It's got to be completely inconspicuous. Even though it's an armored vehicle on tracks, it's got to be inconspicuous. So it's got to look like it belongs there in the bush.
Right. And, okay, so... You can see what I'm drawing right now, correct?
Well, I can see what you're drawing, yeah.
Okay, cool. So, we're gonna do, like... we gotta have a boat-shaped bottom. So, the track's over here, right?
Right.
If it drives over a mine, the mine will explode, and it's sloped armor, so the shots just bounce right off, right?
Of course. That is how sloped armor works.
That's vital. Yes. So we have to have that slope bomb. That's vital. Mm-hmm. It's 2023. Let's be real. Okay, so we got our length here, and we're going to go... Okay, it was... I'm sorry, I'm going to use feet for this.
Oh, you disgusting pleb.
All right, I know, I'm terrible. So 16... fine. Okay, we'll make it 9 meters long. Slash... 30-ish feet. All right, so there's our length. It's still going to be...
You call yourself a true American when you're using dirty, dirty fucking metric...
Hey, I'll be honest. I'm a very large proponent of NATO, and a lot of NATO still uses meters, so that's fine.
Yeah, that's because, like, 99% of NATO is not America.
Exactly. So I'm willing to concede a little bit, you know, just for the sake of our partners that we're helping. So, the height... What is the height? 2.5 meters, so 8 feet. Okay, it's gonna stay the same height, though, because, you know, we can't have it getting too tall. Alright, 8'2", or 2.5, okay. Alright, and the width is...
So it's gonna, it's about as
tall
as the...
Let's say 6 meters.
It's about as tall as the average person.
Yeah.
The thing is, knowing Mike Sparks, he would look at you and go, does it really need to be as tall as the average person? Because no one's going to be standing up in it.
Well, to be fair, it's even taller than that because it's 8.2 feet, but that might also include the cupola. So I'm not... Let's just say for argument's sake, the hull is going to be 6 feet, but we need to make it lower because we need to be able to be hauled down easier.
Yes.
So let's make it 5 feet tall.
Okay.
See, and that's like, what, 2-ish meters?
Yeah. Now you're thinking. Now you're actually using your brain.
Yeah, because the BMP, I mean, it may be an AFV versus an APC, but you know, it's smart enough to be, you know, small and compact. So the guys are hunched over, but it's okay if they're hunched over because they have a lot of leg room now, because we're 6 meters wide and 9 meters long.
Yeah, so they're going to be comfortable. They're going to be crouched in, but they're going to be comfortable, and that is the main thing. Because you need to understand, Mike Sparks has actually been in the military.
Right, of course.
Of course.
And I was thinking, you know, the guys are normally hunched over like this, and there's a little wall in the background, but that wall contracts, and it's a sacrifice in armor while they're taking a shower, but it allows them to lean back.
I see where you're going with this. I do like that. No,
it's a comfort feature.
It is a Let's see if we can evolve that idea a bit better. Let's synergize certainly. Here. You know, those chairs that we're using, could we potentially upgrade that to like a sofa?
Yeah, no, I had the idea that it would be one long bench to begin with, because I'm the best designer in America right now.
Yeah.
Instead of shelling out for individual chairs that recline, we need to just have one big fuck-off, you know, basically a bed or a futon.
Yeah.
This is literally what it is. It's a futon, because the back goes back.
Well, the thing is, we can go to Furniture Warehouse, and we can just pick up a decent-sized sofa.
Exactly.
You chop off the arms of that thing, you are good to go.
So it saves money for the government.
Yeah.
And,
it's generating revenue for our small mom-and-pop businesses, because we can buy exclusively from small-town sofa stores.
Yeah, of course.
Which obviously exists.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like going to Ashley Furniture, and, you know, we just contract them. So, you know, years from now, after World War III ends, Ashley Furniture will be just as valuable as Singer sewing machines were when .45 caliber pistols were made.
Oh, hell yeah.
They made Gavin 2 chairs.
Absolutely.
And, you know, we'll, you know, the average GI can, you know, sprawl out a bit on his reclined futon. Here we go. I'll draw a guy here in a relaxed seductive pose, but I'm going to give him a combat helmet too, because he needs that. Mm. And because, you know, Mike Sparks probably doesn't think we need anything better than the currently obsolete Pazgit helmet because, you know, it's all Kevlar, so who cares? You know, it's got protection over the years.
Well, I mean, it worked for him and it worked for his daddy, so, you know, it's obviously going to work for anyone now.
Exactly.
I mean, if you want, like, a better helmet, you're just a fucking pansy at this point, surely.
Yeah, of course. I think for crew comfort, it would be vital to have a cup holder.
Absolutely, yes.
And a little tiki umbrella.
What I'm going to say is because this is going to be expensive, and Mike Sparks just now is seeing the budget of what how much money we're going to have to spend on this thing, is there a potential that we could bring in a bit of sponsor money to help offset the cost of this new vehicle by introducing, say, like a vending machine?
A vending machine would be ingenious. And also, one of your sponsors would be very, very useful in funding this project. Take it away!
A team from Ukraine is building a first-ever self-assembly 3D wooden model of HIMARS. This unique replica is designed to simulate the firing of both 6G MLRS and 1ATACMS missile via specially designed mechanism. As a special feature, the model comes with a QR code that provides access to an exclusive interview with a real HIMARS operator fighting in Ukraine. Moreover, the project is aimed to benefit charity in Ukraine via Children of Heroes Fund that helps children who lost parents during this war. The project has successfully raised $90,000 on Kickstarter and brought 900-plus backers. To keep the momentum going and welcome new supporters, they have made a pre-order page where anybody can join the project. You can explore the full details of the project and meet the founders on this pre-order page. Support a good cause and own your shooting HIMARS. Check out the link in the description to learn more and join this impactful initiative.
If anyone puts a banana daiquiri into a vending machine, and that sounds like fucking incredible to me, if I'm completely honest with you.
I just thought of something very ingenious to actually incorporate a vending machine.
I'm all ears.
Instead of it being vertical in the cabin and taking up space for one of the guys, it's part of the seat.
So
you got all the fucking choices here. And, like, you know, Dave over here can be chilling with his fucking long legs. And just, you know, if Jim over here, this is Jim, if he's like, yo, hook me up with a banana daiquiri, you know, one of the boys can just slap that and it'll rise. Like, the chute will bring the drink over and rise it straight up through the cup holder.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Because it's got a conveyor belt.
See, this is genius. This is the power of our combined genius is just overwhelming at this point.
I mean, it's us after all, so.
You think about it. In the future, you could be riding into battle, sipping a banana daiquiri.
And you know, I realized something.
What?
I was gonna say, the thing about riding with a banana daiquiri, though, is that you're very vulnerable. Because most APCs and IFVs have aluminum armor.
Mm-hmm.
But we're gonna take a leaf out of Spray's book here, right. And we're going to give this bitch a titanium shell.
Oh, God, you're going to make me come in my pants at this point.
Titanium steel alloy.
Oh, God, yes.
And it's going to have ERA on the outside.
As we all know, titanium is immune to absolutely everything.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly. And, you know, even if anything gets close, we have ERA on the outside. So any infantry walking alongside when this thing gets hit can get immediately vaporized, but that's their fault for walking too close to it.
Yeah, of course.
These vehicles are not meant to support the infantry. They're meant to carry infantry.
Yes. These will take the infantry to their destination, and it's up to the infantry to complete the job.
Of course.
Absolutely, of course. Now, we need to specify there are some threats on the battlefield the ERA cannot protect against. Do you think, just because, you know, we're here and we have the budget, we could potentially equip our new Mike Sparks armored vehicle with a couple of Sidewinder missiles in order to deter our low-flying helicopters doing pop-up attacks and aircraft?
I got one better for you, Laser Pig.
Hit me with it.
We're gonna give it a fucking laser.
Oh, God.
We're living in the year 2023. We are definitely going to give it Sidewinder missiles, but I'll get to that. But the primary defensive armament is going to be a laser system that was pioneered on the 747 AL-1 program. And I think that it probably won't have the range that a Sidewinder would, but...
I'm leaning forward in my chair here. You know, keep going.
Okay. It'll work almost as a trophy system for the 21st century. So it'll be a trophy laser. Wait, I can't spell.
Just spell laser, my name. There you go. There you go.
Yeah. Okay. And the laser will be able to lock onto incoming RPG rounds, high caliber munitions, mortar rounds falling on it, and just zap it like a C-Wiz would with bullets, but it's a laser, so it's a lot cooler.
Okay, so here's the big problem with your laser, which I love the idea of a laser, because we are obviously two intelligent boys, and a laser seems fine. The thing is, Mike Sparks has picked up the phone, and now Pierre sprays in the office, and he's telling us that these lasers...
Oh, fuck.
These lasers are high technology and unreliable, and we should maybe consider something else.
You got me. You got me. So we need a 20mm Vulcan cannon.
Yes.
That's the only way. So I am of the opinion that the M163 VADS turret from 1965 is going to do the job.
It worked in Vietnam, didn't it?
Well, they didn't really use it in Vietnam because they didn't really have any air threats that were worth shooting at back then. I mean, MiGs were mostly up in the north. But, you know, the concept was there. It could shoot them down if it needed to.
Exactly.
And that's why they totally paired it with the M47 Chaparral missile. Like, there was a whole anti-aircraft network that we had. It was genius. One vehicle would have been the VADS, and the other would have been a... AIM-9 Sidewinder-wielding Chaparral system, which carried four AIM-9Ds that can only shoot from the rear quarter, but that's fine, because, you know, they were going to be running away anyway from us. And then the VADS would get anything else. This is how they paired them. This was a common thing. So I think it is very apt to combine the two into one system.
Okay, we are saving money by combining two systems that were previously on separate vehicles together into one.
Yes, exactly. So we are going to create the Volcarel, which is a combination of the two systems that is totally unrelated to the Avenger system that is currently mounted on U.S. military Humvees.
Obviously. Now, I do have one tiny problem here.
Okay.
Because Spray does not think that radar is particularly effective at doing anything. He thinks it's unnecessary. Mm. Can we replace the radar with a bubble canopy?
Yes, actually. You know, I can do one better because the Chaparral didn't even have a bubble canopy. It was just an open turret.
Well, there you go.
Perfect visibility.
I mean, if we give the guy a pair of binoculars, or even go better, we'll give him a telescope.
We'll give him a telescopic sight that is right in front of his eye based on the actual turret elevation.
Yes, and he can use the most powerful equipment that God ever gave to man, which was his own eyes.
The Mark I eyeball, as they say.
Yes.
It'll be perfect. So instead of actually using the radar to search for targets, you know, the VADS use it for ranging and, like, you know, calculating lead, which is, you know, dumb, because you don't need that. The Mark I eyeball does the same.
Yeah.
So if you have an eye, that is a human eye.
It's a human eye. The thing is, I'll do you one better, because most humans have two eyes.
So we're going to do times two.
Yeah.
Times two eye plus Vulcan equals a downed MiG.
Absolutely. That MiG did not stand a chance against
not at all.
Against the new Mike Sparks.
No. And, you know, I'm not even worried about infantry, because the 20mm can engage infantry just fine.
It's dual purpose.
It just needs to level itself.
It's dual purpose. We've cracked it. We've solved it.
Yeah. But these guys chilling out on these reclined chairs,
mm-hmm.
they're probably going to be pretty bored during all this, you know, technological combat. And for morale, it might be worth putting portholes on the side.
Portholes.
And how about some portholes along the side for individual firearms so the fellas can stick out their guns and shoot people?
So they can stick out their guns and shoot people.
Yes. Yes, we've got an audience participation here. Because if they're going to be in there, they may as well do something useful. I mean,
exactly.
I was thinking of something else here.
Okay, go on.
You know, I mean, we've got, like, we've had home entertainment systems for a while. We've had, like, Xbox and PlayStation. We've got Game Boys. And all of these things. Mike Sparks really likes these kind of things, but we're taking up too much power here. We're using too much technology, and Spray's a bit against that. He thinks we're relying too much on technology here. So
sure.
How about as kind of an entertainment prospect, we don't have like any in-flight entertainment. We don't have any movies. We don't have any TVs. We have instead a stripper pole.
Okay, that's pretty fucking good.
Yes.
A 5-foot-tall stripper pole.
Yes, so we can mount inside the machine.
Because it'll make the guy bend over the entire time.
Yeah, but it's going to have everyone hunched over and want to bend
exactly.
over. Yeah, so we have the girl in there, or the femboy. You know, it's your choice.
Sure.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
They're just twirling around the pole, and that's going to keep everyone entertained. I mean, if you've got someone that beautiful twirling around a pole, like, mere inches from your face, you're not going to worry about the explosions and bullets and everything that are clattering off the hull.
No, not at all. It's a good morale, you know, a morale thing. And, you know, we can, you know, the shorter guys can actually, you know, even stand up a little bit and maybe throw some money.
And the best thing, the absolute best thing about it is if anyone kind of needs to, there is the function available that they can zip themselves up for a little bit of privacy, relieve themselves, and potentially have a cold shower.
Yeah. Why a cold one, though?
Well, we haven't installed a boiler system onto our machine yet.
So they'll just have to warm each other up.
They just have to warm each other up. I mean, I suppose if you are going through the desert, that water will be quite warm anyway.
True. That's very true.
Because we do have a giant, because regardless of how small we make this vehicle, there's going to be a giant water tank on the roof.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
I'm also interested, could we potentially make this tank a bit longer? And in
You know, we could probably stretch it to 10 meters.
Yeah, and in the center, could we have, like, bunk beds?
If it's going to be several days,
surely... Oh, no, wait, I have a much better idea. Hang on. Okay, so have you ever seen images of the International Space Station?
Yes.
How do they sleep on the International Space Station?
They sleep vertically.
Yes, they do. And there is absolutely no reason that our modern-day military soldier cannot sleep vertically.
You know, I actually had this... I mean, I think that is a very, very good idea. But if they were sleeping vertically, anybody over 6 feet has to bend their knees. So what I was thinking is having a series of cots...
Go on.
Like three of them, lining the backrest. So whenever they need to take a break, they just bring the cot out and they jump into it.
Oh, that is brilliant.
So we got a guy here and we got a guy hunched over here and the cot's out of the way. It's fine.
Well, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've solved it. We've solved the military.
I just want to point attention to the interior of this fucking vehicle right now.
Yes.
It's pretty lit. I kind of want to go in and hang out.
I mean, we'll have to put mood lighting and stuff inside, because you can't.
Oh, sure.
You just can't look at a stripper if you know the lighting is too harsh. I've tried it; it just doesn't work.
Right. And you know, to be fair, in armored vehicles, most of the lighting is actually red, so
yeah,
it's fine. Yeah,
absolutely. And of course, with the mood lighting. When they've reached their drop-off point, we can change that to green, and then everybody knows to man up and get out.
Exactly. It's perfect.
It is. It's our genius, my genius, and your genius, just is just frankly frightening.
Oh, we're the smartest men in America.
Why are we not funding this?
Because the actual reformers, like people who claim to know what they're doing, are stopping us.
Exactly. It's all government corruption.
And I do have this idea. Do you know what an ArgoCat is?
I don't. Do tell me.
So it is an 8-wheeled off-road vehicle for recreation and like towing trees and whatever. You just go in the woods with it. But it's got wheels. That's the problem. But it's street legal. In addition to its wheels, it has tracks you can put onto it over the rubber wheels.
Mm-mm.
So if you need to change environments... You can do that. So I think this vehicle needs to have road wheels, but the tracks go over the rubber wheels, if you know what I'm saying.
You see, Mike Sparks would disagree with you there, because Mike Sparks just does not believe that rubber wheels belong in a military vehicle. But he does see your point that in rare circumstances, we would need wheels. The thing is, can we do it the other way around?
You mean have tracks that have wheels on them?
Yes. I mean, I know in the prior to the Second World War, there was some ideas thrown around, and one of them was a tank that had both wheels and a track. And when it needed the track, the wheels would kind of lift up.
What the fuck? What?
Okay, so I've struggled to find pictures of it, but I'll add them in if I can find them. Essentially, it's a tank that's on eight wheels.
Mm-hmm.
And it drives along, and then when it needs the tracks, the wheels kind of lift up into the chassis, and then it rests on its track and then drives away.
That's wow. Unique.
Could we not do something like this?
So, as a counterpoint, my idea was that it would be a track vehicle where if the track gets shot off, God forbid, it can drive away on its wheels.
Yeah. So, rather than, the wheel bogies, instead we replace those with just regular wheels with tires.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. The thing is, you're getting into interesting territory here, because as we know, the T-34, the greatest tank in the world, had started life with rubberized road wheels.
You see, that I didn't know.
Yeah.
Also, what kind of suspension are we giving this? Christie suspension? Because we have to, right?
I guess. I mean, what else are we going to go down? Coil suspension? Spring leaf?
No. No.
No.
The M1 Abrams is it's a lemon. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, it's never been proven ineffective in battle. They just explode immediately.
Torsion bars are a joke.
Yeah. What does the M60 use?
Torsion bars.
Oh, that's just Ford's influence. Just coming over here saying, hey, we got this fancy suspension, it's gonna cost a lot of money, and these rich ass generals just going, yeah, baby, whatever. That's the torsion bar suspension. The Christie suspension is obviously the best for any scenario.
So we're gonna have a Christie suspension on rubberized road wheels.
I honestly don't know why they don't use Christie suspension on just, normal civilian cars.
I know, it's not like it breaks or anything.
Yeah, it just boggles the mind.
Yeah, unreal. And then the track goes over the rubber road wheel. It's perfect. Like, it's a compromise that even Mike Sparks would appreciate.
I don't think he does.
Because, the track breaks, and it can just drive away.
It does. So we've now got our armored vehicle.
Yes,
and
we have a box, and we have the armament? Well, at least the defensive armament.
What are you thinking of something with offensive armament in mind?
Well, no, I'm thinking that in addition to its defensive armament being the Vulcan cannon, it needs to have something a little, something with a bit more punch.
What are you thinking?
Well, we can't use the 25 Bushmaster because that's on the Bradley, because, the Bradley is terrible.
It's terrible. And the Bushmaster is a foreign weapon. You can't trust foreigners. Yeah. This has got to be all American,
Of course. I'm thinking, oh boy.
Can I interject with an idea?
By all means.
Okay, so what is the greatest anti-tank weapon in the world?
It's got to be a gun of some kind, because it can't be a missile.
No, missiles don't work.
No. The 120mm smoothbore? No, that's
You're thinking in the wrong direction here.
I'm sorry, my apologies.
The greatest anti-tank weapon ever devised by man, and its inventor is standing right before us, Mr. Pierre Spray here, is the A-10, obviously.
Gau-8.
Yes.
Gau-8. So we'll have a defensive 20mm cannon. And an offensive 30mm cannon.
Yes! I see no way that this could possibly go wrong.
My only concern... So, here we go. I'm gonna erase this. And in the back turret... Well, the problem is that we have troops down here, it has to be a turret that goes on top.
Yeah, of course.
With a gunner. We don't need a loader, and we don't need a tank commander. And this big fuck-off.
There it is!
And the drum of ammunition hangs off of it. right here. Oh, it's beautiful. But, Mr. President, wouldn't that be top-heavy?
He doesn't believe so. No, absolutely not.
Okay, it's wide enough. It's fine.
If it's,
yeah, yeah.
If it's too top-heavy, I mean, it is wide enough, but if it's too top-heavy, we can always put a counterweight on the front.
Sure.
And sure. The thing that is, works. If we put a counterweight on the front, two more people can sit in it. So already, we are expanding what our machine can do.
Beautiful. Beautiful. I love it.
But the thing is, now we've got something that has defensive capability, offensive capability. It can transport troops. It can keep them entertained. It can keep them distracted from the horrors of war that go about them. We've given it the best weapons. We've given it the best suspension system. It is the most mobile thing that has ever existed. And of course, you can operate it, and you can have a shower, which is the most important thing here. But Sparks is asking us if we can bring it up a level.
Okay.
Now, as we all know, Mike Sparks originally invented a similar machine built on the greatest armored vehicle on the planet, which was the Gavin, in which he was able to make the Gavin fly. And as we all know, we took on the Soviet Union with hordes of these aerogavins just dropping paratroopers and then landing in to support the troops with heavy machine gun fire. Now, can we do the same here?
I think we absolutely can, given the budget.
Given the budget. I want to hear your ideas on how we can make this thing fly.
Okay, so the original Gavin obviously was powered by a single turbo prop engine and a biplane arrangement.
Yes.
This is obviously a bigger vehicle. And there are a lot of B-1 bombers going out of service here pretty soon. So I think the engines will be in surplus. So let me just open up a new tab here.
I like where you're going with this.
Because the best way to infiltrate something is to go low and fast. You know, nap of the earth, you know, low altitude penetrator shit.
Yeah, we got to take advantage of like gorges and dry riverbeds and everything to avoid radar detection.
So my concept, I'm going to draw a quick sketch here. This is not going to be very technical at all. I apologize.
It's fine. This is just rough. You know, this is for the investors.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, of course.
I mean, do try to make it neat. I mean, we're always sitting in front of the President of the United States.
Of course, of course, of course. I'm sure Mr. President would be very impressed with us.
No, absolutely. Oh, he's loving this so far.
Okay, good, good. That makes me feel a little better. I was stressed out. So we've got our two cannons on there, a 30mm and our 20mm. And we have the wing gloves of the B-1 on here. And we have their swept wings.
Mm-hmm.
And the benefit of working with a B-1 platform, you know, after they scrap them all and, you know, cut them to pieces, is that there will be a lot of scrap from the aircraft, so we can just apply that to the vehicles. And the Army loves getting scrap from them. And we'll give it a V-tail because that looks cool.
Absolutely, yes. So already we are building a set of scrap metal from all those discarded, terrible B-1s that didn't work.
Yeah, of course. And we'll give them the four engine pods.
Absolutely.
And it will be a supersonic penetrator. I think this is what we need. And, you know, I say supersonic penetrator, but really, it's high subsonic.
Yeah.
It's doing about 600 knots, about 200 feet.
You need to add in a couple of AIM-9 missiles there, just in case any MiGs, you know, try to sneak up on us.
Oh, of course, of course. You know, there was actually a concept for the B-1 called the B-1R that was canceled because it was, you know, just not... It was introduced in the wrong time.
Mm-hmm.
And they had this idea where it was going to be a missile truck packing all AIM-120 missiles. So it would pack like 16 AIM-120 AMRAMs, and F-22s would paint them with radar or whatever, and the B-1s would, you know, launch on them from distances. So I think we need to apply that concept here.
I think so.
Oh, wait, yeah, no, we can't, because BVR is ineffective and it's a waste of time.
The thing is, you're relying too much on missiles here. We already have the GAU-8.
That's my mistake.
And we have a 20mm Vulcan there. So, you know, that's all right, all right. In turret configuration nonetheless. But, you know, just in case we do, because turrets are obviously ineffective in a dogfight, turret fighters are terrible. They've never worked. So how about, just in case, we give the driver a couple of dual 50 cals?
Yes. Sticking right out of the front, right?
Right, just right out of the front, just in case we do get into that dogfight.
All right, let's do that. Let's do that. Dual 50s. Right there.
Right
Hell
there.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Okay,
that's perfect. That is absolutely perfect. Now, continue.
I was just going to say, the benefit of having Sidewinders is that it doesn't require radar, which Pierre Spray obviously thinks is a horrible idea, which it is.
Yes.
So we'll have a pair of Sidewinders on each side. We have afterburning turbofan engines. This thing could dogfight MiGs.
It could.
Yeah.
I mean, we could be using this thing for air superiority. We could have
absolutely
an air superiority version. You know, we don't have to have troops in the back.
Right.
Yeah. And therefore, you don't have troops in the back. You save weight. We've got an air superiority version of this thing.
Yeah. This is pretty impressive. I will include a little tail boom here because it's good to have an option for a single guy to hang out in it and man a tail gun.
Oh, yeah.
Because tail guns are very important. You know, if you have a MiG coming up on you, I'm going to draw a little fish bed here. If you have one of these fuckers crawling up on you, you want to be able to clear it. And the Gal 8, as much as, as effective as it is blocked by the tails. So you have to have something that's out here. And this guy here will be the caretaker of the wings after they get departed. Because as you said in your Sparks video, the wings get left behind and they're unmanned.
Yes.
Right?
Now we have a caretaker.
Yeah, we have a guy there with an M4, chilling out, having a smoke. If anybody comes up to it, he can stop him.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
So the problem with civilians trying to take souvenirs, that's been solved.
Yeah.
And the thing is, we all know tail gunners are important because the Russian military still uses them.
Of course. On the backfires and the TU-95s and... 22Ms have a tail gun still, so it's perfect.
Yeah, it is perfect.
We're better than Russians.
We're 100% better than Russians. We are beating Russia its own game. But can I go with a slightly different suggestion here? Now feel free
to shoot.
Feel free to shoot me down on this one. All right, because this is a bit of a wild one. But
Okay.
In my previous conversation with Mike Sparks, we had a brief discussion about the problem with close air support.
Ah, oh, yes, of course.
Yes, now, at the time, the A-10 was under consideration of being replaced, which is obviously tragedy because the A-10 is the greatest close air support weapon in existence, but...
Pierre Spray is in the room with us right now.
He is in the room with us. He is already offended that anyone would even be considering such a travesty. So,
of course.
So, here's the thing, okay? Just in case... Now, we have the wings, we have the missiles, we have everything there that we need, but... Just as a backup, we go for one of Mike Sparks' old ideas. Now, his old idea for a new close air support weapon was a sort of a very cheaply made, cheaply powered loitering munition that you could hover above the battlefield and deliver ordnance to whatever was down there. It could easily target, whatever was on the ground using whatever cannons it had available. Now,
cannons. I was going to say missiles, but
we're talking cannons here. Cannons are way more reliable. Artillery, the god of war here. Now,
the god of war, yes.
I see what you're doing here is you're drawing a plane.
Yes.
Now, I need you to understand that you're going in completely the wrong direction here, because planes go fast.
Oh.
You understand what I'm saying.
Drawing a helicopter?
No. Helicopters are unreliable. They just break apart the second you put them in the air.
Of course, my bad.
Of course. So
please don't fire me.
I'm not going to fire you. It's fine. You're new to this. Okay. You're learning. We all make mistakes. That's fine. No, Mike Sparks' great idea about this new loitering munition, this new close air support vehicle that could hover in the air and just provide instant close air support to anything on the ground was a Zeppelin.
Ah, okay, thinking big, okay.
Thinking big
here. So you have a Zeppelin orbiting at like 60,000 feet.
Yes.
Just vibing around, everybody's on oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
And it can't just look like an old Zeppelin, so it's got to like have angular fins on it.
Absolutely, yes.
No. And it can't even look like a regular Zeppelin. It's gotta have like a shape to it. It's gotta have sloped armor.
You're thinking with portals now, my friend. You know, sloped armor in a Zeppelin. Holy fucking Christ!
It's gotta look like the fucking thing from the Navigator.
Oh hell yeah!
Yeah, here we go. And instead of having the cupola on the bottom here, you know, no, that's old news. We gotta have it up here on front. Like an old Buck Rogers rocket ship.
No, keep going. This is perfect. This is beautiful.
And it's got this little engine to the bottom propelling it along. Brrr.
Yeah. Now, can we put a Goey on it?
Yes.
Yes.
Right in the bottom, because the cupola isn't on the bottom anymore, so the galley gets to stick out
here. Yes.
No.
Okay, now, what we do is we attach docking clamps to the bottom of that, and it can now pick up our Mike Sparks and just transport that wherever it needs to be.
Just like the Crimson Skies, the video game.
Just like Crimson Skies, the video game. And that way, the Mike Sparks does not have to waste its expensive and precious fuel. And we can put our refueling rod from our new, rocket / Zeppelin onto the new Mike Sparks to refill its water, to provide it with more banana daiquiris, to replace out the whore that's on the stripping pole.
Exactly.
In fact, you know what? We could build, because we've got this huge Zeppelin now, and all that free space inside, because it's just air inside these things. There's nothing really in there. It's just air. So we could fill that with bunk beds and a proper shower room and a kitchen. Yeah, we have this floating base that can service these.
Yeah, absolutely.
These are new Mark II Aero Mike Sparks.
I think we have a winner here. This is too perfect.
This is too perfect, yes. You're destroying the infidels there, I love it.
Yeah, those are the enemies of America. This is how we're gonna get Russia.
This is it. This is how we're going to save Ukraine.
I think we should have had this 20 years ago, honestly.
I think what we need to do is we need to get a flight to Ukraine now, and we just need to sit down in front of Zelensky and say, Zelensky, all your problems are over. Behold, the Aero Sparks Mark II.
I hope Zelensky sees this video someday. You know, honestly, though,
I can promise you he will not.
We say that. You gotta dream, though.
You gotta dream big. You gotta dream big, and that world leaders are watching us right now and going, my God, we need to give these people millions of dollars out of the black budget right now. They need to develop our new weapon systems. These people are genius.
You know, I'm looking at the Zeppelin right now. It looks pretty fucking awesome, actually.
Yeah, we've created art. I do gotta ask, how are you propelling that thing?
These two little fucking propeller jobs here.
Little propeller fans?
Yeah, because the original Gavins were retired, so the propellers that were powering them had to be used for something else.
Fantastic. I do like that. That is... Yes.
It's all about repurposing.
It's all about repurposing. We've cracked it. We've done it. High five.
I think we're getting a raise.
I think so. Do you want to end it there? Because I don't think we can top that.
Yeah, no, that was pretty great. Oh man.
Okay, I'm gonna stop the recording there.